Good evening all, allflavasradio.com, land all flavors land. How is everyone doing out there? Wishing you all well. On what is the date today, Lily? 24th of November. Wow. We're feeling a little bit under the weather here today, aren't we? We're both feeling a little bit rough.
Yeah, very rough and in a lot of pain.
Oh, hush. we'll get through this, okay? We'll be fine. We'll be all right. So, got lots in store for you tonight, and wow, what a heated show. I'm Wimbo77.
And I'm Naturally Lily.
Oh, so how's your week been? How's your day been?
It's been okay.
Yeah?
Yeah, nothing too exciting, just struggling alone, but it's been all right.
I hear you. And we get days like that.
Mm-hmm.
We get up and down days, right?
Yeah.
So we just got to roll. It's just a bit like surfing a wave.
Yeah.
You wait for that wave to come. Some things are really smooth. And then the wave comes.
Just got to get over that wave.
You've got to ride that wave just to get through. And that's what life is all about. But seeing the positive in riding that wave, because a lot of people get enjoyment out of riding it, right?
Yeah, this is true.
There you go. So how are you all doing out there? How was your start end? I must say, a really fantastic day of music over the start end Saturday and Sunday from the All Flavors DJs, All Flavors crew. I'll be giving you a shout very soon. And last night as well, DJ Mark Philogen, DJ Slim, and also Mr. Fixit on a Monday night, doing some really great things. Like we say, you always get a variety from all flavors. That's why all flavors means they're flavorsome. All right, so we'll be kicking off with tonight. I know that you've been really itching to speak about this, because when we saw it, it was something quite disturbing, I thought.
I don't know if I'm itching to speak about it.
Oh, did you hear that deep breath? Yeah, very deep breath.
So, should we speak about the Sainsbury's advert? Should we just get it out of the way?
Let's speak about the Sainsbury's advert. Now, I don't know if you guys have seen it. I was able to catch it. I think on YouTube I was able to see it.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, I loved it. Right? Mm-hmm. Nice black family. I'm sure you're going to explain a bit more. But it was the backlash. It's a bit like the Britain's Got Talent situation.
Oh, no. This is a lot bigger, I think, than the Britain's Got Talent.
Okay. So what you're feeling
backlash. So, for some background to what we're discussing, there has been a series of holiday adverts done by Sainsbury's. There's three parts.
Mm-hmm.
And the first part happened to feature a very beautiful black family.
Yeah.
And wow, some of the comments.
I know, they were shocking. And it was a black family, meaning that there was a father present.
Yeah, everyone, the mum, the children, the dad, there was a couple of other family members there that they didn't really, that you didn't know who that was. There was cousins or whatever.
Yeah.
Around the nice table having dinner. Mm. I felt there was a few innuendos in there, but it was a nice representation of a black family.
Yeah.
The comments. Now, I'm going to have to read a couple of these because... just so people understand where I'm coming from. So we had comments like, this doesn't represent me. I don't see myself in this at all. I can't relate. Possibly the worst Christmas ad I've ever seen. Well done, Sainsbury's. I'll shop at Tesco's. Carry on being woke and watch the share price drop. This was, I had two favourites. The first one was, let me see if I can find it. Christmas in Nigeria.
Yep.
That was the first one. And the second one was, just wondering whether in their portrayal of a typical black family, the male adult is actually the father of the children. Quite often, this isn't the case.
Some really seriously degrading. Sick. Yeah. And that one. You might as well rename yourself Blackberries.
Oh, come on.
Right? So you don't see much of us on the television. And So it's really nice. And given the fact that this is just one advert in a series of three adverts, mm-hmm. the other two adverts do highlight white families.
Mm-hmm.
But obviously with all maybe the whole BAME thing and this Black Lives Matter thing, they felt, because Tesco did one as well.
I was just going to say that. I found it very interesting that they mentioned the dad in the advert.
Yeah.
They're saying it's not typical, because the two Tesco's adverts that come to mind was, the first one was a grandma, a nanny, who's relatively young. She might be in her 50s, and she picked up her son, grandson from school, who wasn't feeling well, and she made him soup. Black grandma, black grandson. The second one was of a foster mother, so an older black lady who was making jerk chicken for the family, for her foster children, again representing a black person.
Yeah,
did not hear any backlash for those adverts. And this is what brought it home to me as to why certain people got so offended by this advert. This one comment where they talk about the portrayal of a typical black family. In the Sainsbury's advert, the little girl actually says daddy.
Yeah.
And then she says, oh, I don't know how mum puts up with you. And then he calls his wife honey, or his partner honey. So they're seemingly a happy family.
Yeah, yeah.
And I feel like that is what infuriated those that watch this advert so much, is the fact that it was a happy
black family.
Solid. Everyone present.
Yes.
Black family. And no, it's not a, isn't the case. This isn't quite often, because most of the people I grew up with were from two-parent households.
So what's your thoughts on the ad? I don't know if you've seen it, everyone. I'm not sure if you've had a chance to read any of the comments that were given by the public on the advert. And are you happy to actually see yourself in an advert, because it's very rare. There was another Tesco's one, and it's the model that was in it. It was again meant to be a black couple.
Yeah.
But obviously, because of all of the Sainsbury's hoo-ha,
yeah,
they actually removed the black couple out.
Stop it.
They removed the black couple out of the advert. It was the model that went on and spoke about it.
Now, because they were scared people were going to stop shopping there.
Maybe, who knows, but one of the comments was that there's only 4%
black population. Black people, yeah.
Is that very true? Can anyone tell me, is there only 4% of a black population in this country? Because I'm sure it's more. We're going to go on and look at some other things that really are affecting our community. And I mean, this was just a 30-second ad on the TV?
Do you know what the thing is, though? I don't actually, because someone made a comment in one of their complaints about it being, oh yeah, you're trying to make the BAME community happy. I don't think it was anything to do with them making us happy. I honestly think, as a community, we don't really shop in Sainsbury's. I don't know a lot of people from our community that shop in Sainsbury's.
I think quite a few do, actually.
Yeah, because yeah, I almost definitely. Thought like that they was thinking, do you know what, let's make this more relatable to them so that they do come do their holiday shopping at Sainsbury's, and they don't go to Tesco's and they don't go to Aldi and all those other places. So I thought it was more of a marketing thing, which makes more sense to me. I don't feel like they thought, oh no, black people are not represented on television. Let's get them to spend their money in our, let's get, you know, get them on our screens.
Well, no, because they've made a series of three. So they're trying to reach their whole demographic, because I know that Sainsbury's, that they have quite a large employment, black employment, people employed with them.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just an advert with black people in it. Well, should I say it like that? Am I being really flippant to say
it's
just,
not?
To
no,
me, to
you're
me.
Not. That's because when we watch it, we don't see. Oh, the dad's in the advert. Like that didn't even register until we read the comments afterwards.
Yeah.
So that doesn't register to us. And then when I think one of the things why people also got so offended is the fact that it was the first of the three, and when they made their statements about I don't see me being represented, actually the next two are predominantly British families.
Yeah.
If we want to be that flippant about it, they are white British families. Maybe Sainsbury's could have done it in a different order. I don't know. I don't see why it would have made a difference, because they'll still see a united black family.
Yeah, but obviously they are embracing that because they do have lots of black employees, because they have lots of customers, they're embracing diversity and inclusion, because diversity and inclusion, it has come into play in a lot of policy. So they're trying to meet policy, yet it's also shown up that there's a whole set of racism that's not been tackled in this country. It's really highlighted how people feel when it comes to racism. All right, now I don't like to speak too much on racism, but we just have to accept it.
It's just,
and acknowledge it.
It's what is in the air at the moment. It's like we talk about current events. This is current, isn't it? It's something that's happened within the last week or so. So we have to, you know, it might not be everyone's cup of tea speaking about these things, but actually we are tackling something that at this moment, this is something that's quite predominantly out there. The fact that they've now, like you're saying, Tesco's have completely changed an advert because of how certain people have responded, it is something that needs to be spoken about.
Yeah, and we need to speak up more, because I think what it is as well, that it says until this year, there was a huge lack of diversity. And we know that a while ago we spoke about the Small Axe, the Steve McQueen movie that was going to be aired.
Yeah.
Again, that's had a lot of backlash from our community.
Okay.
Right? Because it was, again, not a real representation of us. I mean, that black family in Sainsbury's, I think that was quite a real representation.
Yeah. Because I saw our family on television.
Right.
You know, when you look back to how things were when you was growing up and how we are, even currently, when we have dinners and things like that, we have...
We're all together.
Everybody together. Mum, dad, grandma, granddad, you know. I don't know.
So what are your thoughts out there? What are your thoughts on the Sainsbury's advert? I don't know if you've seen it. Join the case says that 4% counted. So does that mean, again, this is something we spoke about before, when we go in to sign forms or whatever, do we put down our ethnicity? Because they do ask us that, and it's not necessarily for fishing, but to be counted. Are we all being counted? Last week, was it, we spoke about the ethnic and diversity
Form to fill in,
yeah, the form,
education in that.
So have we gone on and done that? Have we gone on and stated it was the consultation of ethnic disparities and inequality in the UK? So have we gone in and filled in that form? Because until we do, we're going to keep seeing these things happening. All right, this whole, I mean, it shows us we've still got a very, very long road to travel.
I think because we live in London, in a quite diverse, we can call it a diverse area, we are seeing ourselves, we walk out of our front door and we see ourselves. But when, for example, I've gone to like view houses and stuff, and you go to certain areas where it may not be, they may not, it's like spot the black person. In those areas, maybe that's why this is kind of come up, because people in those areas feel like they're not being represented on television because of one advert.
I understand that. And I guess there's more of a multicultural demographic in the cities as opposed to out of the cities. Because we, do you remember, we went to Ware?
Yeah.
And to the garden centre. There were no black people there. The woman at the checkout, she was a bit funny, wasn't she? Or have you got your mask on and like whatnot? And you know, so we because we've always done that, travelled out regardless. You know, you get funny looks. We went to Pwelly, remember Pwelly Wells? It's like people just stare at you. So maybe that could be part of the issue. Maybe it's just that they don't see us where they are, as you said.
Yeah, they're not in there, they're not around Asian people, black people, Nepalese people, Filipino people. They're not around that demographic every day. They don't go to work and see those people every day. Even if they're working in hospitals and, you know, dentists and GP practices and places like that, where you may think there might be a bit more traffic with a more diverse population.
Yeah.
They may literally live in that area where there is no very few and far between.
Right, so let's know your thoughts out there. How do you feel about the Sainsbury's advert? How have you seen it? And have you seen the comments that were made regarding the Sainsbury's advert? And we do need to see more of each other on the TV. Yes, Lily.
So I have a comment on WhatsApp, because someone can't get into the chat room, and from Kimmy. She said she wants to add that it seems that they obviously can relate more to Kevin the Carrot from the Aldi advert than black people. And that is actually very true, because no one complains about seeing
a carrot
representing them at Christmas. But there is a very, very big...
I've not seen that advert, Carrot.
We don't watch TV. The only reason we saw this advert is because it came up in... someone had brought our attention to it. And then I did actually see... I didn't see this one on television. I saw the... I think it's the second part or the third part last night when I was watching TV, actually. But generally, I wouldn't have come across this. And Kevin the Carrot is from last year as well. He was on Aldi's advert from last year. But I think it also shows the kind of people that are shopping. I think there is a type of person, in my opinion, that is very ignorant and small-minded that makes these kind of comments.
Yeah.
And maybe I'm trying to kind of find some leeway, not make an excuse, but understand why people make these pathetic statements.
It is ignorance.
But yeah, because I do think it's a type of person. I don't think it's like... I don't know. I really don't know. It's the Christmas in Nigeria sentence that got me. Yeah. Like, so we're all...
Nigerian.
Every black person they've ever met is Nigerian.
I mean, and the one that says, I'm dreaming of a white Christmas. Like, are you kidding me? It doesn't snow in this country. So that was obviously pertaining to something else. Yeah? So, your thoughts. Joy says that most of the times it's black people shopping in Sainsbury's. So they are trying inclusion. And that's a great thing. She says, however, diversity in the outer suburbs, black people are scarce, and the racist mostly reside there, as you said, Lily. Mm. So totally agree with you, Joy, that, the further you go out is the less of us you see. You'll see us in the city, but the more that we go out into the suburbs, you will see or meet a lot of maybe racist people. We can't speak for everybody, but the comments that we saw on WhatsApp are atrocious.
Yeah.
They're really atrocious, and this stuff has to stop. We do have a very long way to go, and I mean, this whole year has been kind of centered around that, would you not say?
And I think that's why it's more in your face, because of the way the situation has started. From, we can look back to last year, kind of November, December time, when the whole situation with Corona and COVID-19 started, and then it kind of became it wasn't so much a race thing, it was more of a, this disease has come from someone who's not like me.
Yeah.
Namely, it came from China. And then when it became, oh no, all the people on the front line are dying, and it so happened that most of the people on the front line were black, that's when it became
a black thing.
Yeah. And then they made this whole, we need to make sure we can protect our BAME, make sure that they're looked after, make sure they're this, make sure they're that. That then, like, if you're thinking about it from the other person, putting yourself in the other person's shoes, they're gone from being, it's all about me, to now I've got to give attention to you, when in my heart of hearts, I actually don't like you, and I'm nice to you because we work together, but now everything's about you and I don't really like that.
But
and then the switch just flipped.
Yeah, in work I think it's apparent, it's there, but they're just very good at hiding it. They're just very good at just, you know, when they close and they start calling names. I've been on gigs and people have called me names, because sometimes we go to these areas and again, it's predominantly white. Or if there is a black person there, he's like the butt of everyone's jokes.
Yeah.
You know? So we do have a long way to go when it comes to racism. How are we going to tackle that? How are we going to tackle it? It's something that's not... It's been here since day dot, I guess.
Mm.
And we're still having to put up with this nonsense.
Honestly, though... Someone, I think it was you that said it, or someone said it, if we are the 4%, why are you so threatened by seeing the 4% on television? Because you see 97% of yourself on television, and you are clearly the ones that are sitting down watching it from morning till noon, if that's what you're doing during lockdown, fair enough. But why are you so threatened by someone that doesn't look like you?
Well, it could be as well, because when you look at it, Lewis Hamilton, he won the title, is the best one since whenever. The Williams sisters, smashing it. We just smash everything. So they've seen enough of us. We've entertained them enough so that we don't want to see you as a happy family having a meal, singing the gravy boat song.
I feel like that is also subliminal, though. Like, I tried. I really, really, really tried not to think about the gravy. But the gravy and the boat, like, that's like slightly racist as well. The black family, you give us the boat. Like, really?
Yeah, so it's still, they try not to, but it's just so present. It's just so there in your face kind of thing, you know. And we're just happy to be there because we've all had to break molds.
Mm.
There are a lot of black folk through the centuries, down through time, that had to break molds to be even sat here having this conversation.
Mm.
Right? But yet we still have a long way to go.
I'm going to be brutally honest. Mm. I have been happily ignorant on the race issue for quite a long time. I worked with people that don't like me because I'm black. And I don't care. And I've not really paid much attention to the whole black and white thing. Brexit was the first time I think it kind of hit a nerve, because that's when I started getting treated differently with people that I actually worked with. But I have been happily ignorant. I've not been focused on this whole black and white issue. I'm happy with being around my family, my friends who are similarly minded to me. Like, I'm happy just ticking the box Black Caribbean and getting on with it. Do you know what I mean? I'm not that activist, that innovator, that, oh, let's make a change or whatever. But being the last 6 months to a year and seeing certain behaviours and attitudes, it is very difficult now. As much as you don't want to get involved in the race issue, as much as you don't want to be that person that says white person, black person, Asian person, Chinese person, unfortunately, it's being shoved down your throat. Even to the point where now at work, I had to tick a box to say that I was present for a certain activity. I said out loud at work, I'm insulted. Because why do I have to, why am I a box tick?
Yeah,
do you understand? And it's not that it's never affected me, because yeah, people have said racist things to me, but I honestly, I don't care because I know how I feel about what I look like and who I am. What you say don't mean nothing. You're not going to change what I look like.
We are who we are, aren't we?
I'm not Michael Jackson. Do you know what I mean? It's not going to change who I am.
Yeah.
But of the situation that we're in right now, I know people are saying, oh, you shouldn't say this and you can't say this and whatever.
What were we meant
to
say?
This is how it is.
It is. And it's been like that for, like I said, since day dot. You know, but as Joyce says there, sign a petition that people will bring change. We've been going since the civil rights movement. We've been going from before the civil rights movement, since slavery, since before slavery. And so on and so forth. But change will come. We're going to tackle some other issues in the next parts of this show. So do stick around and let us know your thoughts. Give us a shout on 07895 134713. That's 07895 134713.
The best radio station in the world.
In the world.
Allflavasradio.com is right here.
Right now.
Hi everyone, this is Shayla Frostbear, and I have a new album out, and it's called Under My Skin. Filled with high energy jams like this. Smooth.
website, shaylaprospermusic.com, and enjoy this collection of rich, warm, contemporary soul and R&B cuts that you will enjoy in your playlist for years to come. Under My Skin out
now. Tune in to All Flavas Radio, Saturdays 8 to 10 with DJ Nigi and the Shortiest Show, one of E's Lewis' favorite hangouts.
All Flavas Radio is now looking for radio presenters. Email us at info@allflavasradio.com.
Catch DJ Laro on Sundays with the Caribbean Party, 12 to 2, and the Vibe Show, Tuesdays 8 till 10 on All Flavas Radio.
24/7 playing your favorite artists.
Hi, this is Everton Blender, and it's all about the Old Flavors Radio.
Sit in your man Bushman, and guess what? You got it locked to our flavors.
Bumpa Scario, I say come take a little winding up. Ayo, it's a girl calling XB, the Booyah Queen, straight out of Dominica. Bigging up All Flavors Radio, keep it locked.
All Flavors Radio.
The sweet sounds, sweet, sweet sounds of Terry Walker. What Will I Do? And also the first track that we played was by Lala Hathaway from way back in the day. Great album, that one as well. So here we were speaking about the Sainsbury's advert, right, Lily?
Yeah.
And how the family are all complete. They're happy. They're together. Even Joy McKay made the point about getting together at Christmas. Now, I don't necessarily celebrate Christmas. There's a lot of people that don't, but we still use it as a time to get together.
Yeah.
As families. Yes, Lily?
No, I just wanted to read this lovely comment
from
Sonia in Germany. And she says, we don't have the advert here in Germany, so I've not seen it fully.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't identify with skin colours or looks, but with the inside of humans or their spirit, if I was into Christmas in this case. So I don't think at all it should matter to anyone what skin colour anyone has. Who cares about percentages? It should be about the message. It's so frustrating that racism still exists. We're all humans. And I just think that's such a beautiful comment, because it goes back to when I was saying that I've been happily ignorant. Because one of the reasons is I do have friends from all different walks of life, from different ethnicities, different skin types, whatever. And I find it really annoying,
weird,
and frustrating
sorry
when I have to justify how and why I'm someone's friend.
Yeah,
because like Sonia said, why does it matter what they look like?
And it's quite funny, do you remember the Ruby Bridges?
No.
She was a young girl, and she was one of she was the one that went to school when they didn't want a black child to go to school.
Yeah.
And what she said, because I saw an interview with her recently, and what she said was that even the children, so she never saw the children until one day there was someone they wanted to play with her.
Mm-hmm.
And then there was one other little boy, and he said, my mummy said,
yeah,
I'm not allowed to play with you. So she never held it against him, because it's things that we can instill into our youngsters.
Yeah.
Right. So that's one thing. That's why I'm not really, I really do agree with Sonia's comment there, that we are all human beings. We are all human beings. The sad thing is that some just feel that they're more privileged than others, and that's where the problem, this is where the whole breakdown comes, because we all have the same bodily functions. We all need the same things. We all need air. We all need water to survive. Right?
Yeah.
But it's just, the sad thing is that some people feel that they're more privileged, and that's the trouble. And that moves us into the next topic. And that is the breakdown of the black family.
Yes.
I think that black families are a lot stronger these days.
Mm-hmm.
But again, we still have a lot or a long way to go when it comes to that.
I think it's one of those, I don't know, like obviously back in the day, that even when we talk about the breakdown of the black family, you can look at places like the projects and certain estates and that, where you would be entitled to certain things if you never had your man with you.
Yeah.
You could get certain benefits if you're a single parent. If you're a single mum, you could get entitlement to, you know, different kind of things. And one thing that I have always felt
is that, no, you don't always have two parents there, but it really does make a difference when there are two parents there. Ooh, yeah. And then when you look at the difference between how some people function, so people who haven't been brought up in two-parent households as opposed to single-parents households, they're not necessarily, you know, so destitute that they can't survive,
mm.
but you do need that.
You need both parents.
You do.
Yeah.
I don't understand why they have actively tried to destroy the black family.
Again, that was another experiment that was done in the States, you know, with the projects. That's why we were project. They were a project.
Mm-hmm.
And we can see how far removed that they are. They couldn't buy houses,
mm.
you know, real estate. But now there are ones that are breaking through, mm-hmm. that we spoke of one the other day. I can't remember his name. Was it Ludacris or someone? One of the...
T.I.,
yeah. The rapper that's building up within the community, mm-hmm. to make it a better place for the black family to be.
Mm.
But what is quite interesting is the no men allowed. The no men allowed. Because once you don't have a man, say, for mm-hmm. instance, that you get everything to a degree, right? That's if you're a single mother. But it doesn't mean that the father shouldn't be present.
Mm.
But the government have worked out a way that they're totally excluded.
Do you know, it's funny because until I had my child,
mm.
then I realised how much the government, to a certain point, do not support families, mm. in general. I'm not just talking about the black family, I'm talking about families in general.
Yeah.
A two-parent household can sometimes be worse off than if you've got two parents living in separate households.
Yeah.
For simple things, like, for example, childcare. I work a job,
yeah,
and I have to pay for my child to go to nursery. Fine. Someone else...
Not working.
Who's not working.
Yeah.
Who may or may not be a single parent, is getting benefits,
mm-hmm.
gets that payment subsidised.
Yeah.
But they're not working.
Yeah.
And I'm working. And I... Both me and my husband are working. And we need that person. We need to put them into... No provision for families.
Mm.
And I think that is where this system is warped.
Yeah.
It is. It just doesn't make any sense to me. Where... Not that we're saying, you know... No, yeah, I am saying, where is the support of the family?
Mm. It's going right back to that, the advert again, what the woman said, is that the real father of the children?
Yeah.
So already it's in the mind that,
yeah.
Well, that's not the real father.
Yeah.
You know, so what can anyone out there answer? What has happened? I mean, I think black families are a lot stronger
mm.
now than they ever were, because yeah. we're realising that, yeah, we got to work together and to raise our children,
mm.
you know, but there still is that divide with, you know, lots of maybe single parents out there that aren't working. Okay, we're going to take this call.
Hello.
Hey, good evening. How are you good ladies doing this evening?
Yes, we're good. How are you?
I'm not too bad. I'm not bad. Again, another great show.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's a pleasure to listen to the conversation this evening.
Mm.
It's some positive, some negative, but yeah. I'm just quickly calling up just to highlight about the black family. I think it's already been highlighted some of the issues that we're facing, although yeah. it has improved. But when you talk about projects in this country, we're talking about estates. We're not just talking about access to funds and employment benefits, but when you look at the whole structure,
mm.
it's the living conditions. Then you look at access to healthcare,
mm-hmm.
and education around those areas.
Mm.
It's no wonder that it's difficult for not all, but some black families to rise above the situations that they're facing.
Mm.
Just trying to make ends meet. And then trying to control the environment that your kids are going into, that you're having to go into. It's a pressure cauldron.
Mm.
And some people can't handle it. And as we well know, unfortunately, this country has never been for me personally, family orientated. So when you throw that in as well,
yeah,
it's very difficult for black families, not just black families, as we know. We're just not making this a black thing.
Yeah.
I like to highlight that as well. It's not, as I said, not just a black thing, but there's a lot of pressures.
Yeah.
On black families at the moment, and it's very, very difficult.
Mm.
Because it's affecting all aspects of a family's life. Education, welfare, access, as I said, to health care and well-being, it's the mental health. So there's a lot for black families to contend with. Mm. As you highlighted, it is improving, yeah, but there's still a lot of pressure. Still a lot, yeah, of pressure on us, still. Mm. And that's what I wanted to highlight, actually.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure. Thank you for allowing me to call in. Oh. And enjoy the rest of the show. I'm sure I'm going to enjoy the rest of the show.
To you, Will.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Right.
Yeah. I want to hone in on something that that was just said about education. And I think this, for me, is somewhere that's close to my heart, because obviously I'm a work in education.
Mm.
When you look at, we're talking about the disadvantaged areas, and the disadvantaged families tend to have more of a multicultural demographic.
Yeah.
And when it comes to funding of schools, that is one thing that I think, I know a lot of our community don't agree with the education system, they don't agree with the curriculum, they don't agree with those kind of things. But we, within our community now, are starting to develop, you know, we've got entrepreneurs, we've got businessmen, we've got people who are, you know, we're getting that wealthy status.
Yeah.
And one thing that our community doesn't do, that the other communities may, is they may contribute to the funding of the schools.
Yeah, because now I think it's per student. Depending if it's an academy,
yeah,
or a state-run school,
yeah,
finances are very, very different.
Yeah, right. Yeah. So the funding that goes into education at the moment, it's not a priority, in my opinion,
yeah,
of the government. But when you look at some of the academies and the grammar schools,
mm,
or some of the grammar schools, sorry, or maybe private schools, that demographic of people that are putting those children into that school are also, most of the time, not all of the time, but most of the time, contributing to the funds that are given, yeah, to the school. So those schools are able to give, you know, that extracurricular
more resources,
yeah, and that kind, yeah, of thing for the students.
Yeah.
So when we're looking at within our own community and the demographic that we're living in, and the fact that we do have a more mixed of cultures within our schools,
yeah,
knowing now that we are becoming more, we are getting that wealth status, and we do have entrepreneurs and business people,
yeah,
what are we doing to then help the funds of those deprived schools?
Yeah, we can contribute, and we can contribute in a financial way,
mm,
but also through the skills that we have. So even if we go in and do a workshop, work, yeah, in line with the schools to help them see that they can build things, such as have a, I think we wanted to do a workshop with,
yeah,
well, we won't speak too much of it, but we've got an idea, you know, and working with young people in, mm, order for them to benefit,
mm,
from the skills and the, you know, the sets that we have in order to help them to elevate,
mm,
out of that state, and also delivery it at either no cost,
mm,
or at a very, what do they call it,
minimal cost, yeah,
right, to, so that they too can learn these things.
Mm.
You know,
because I don't think so much the issue now is the breaking up of the family,
mm,
because like you're saying, a lot of the families now are united. We do have mum, dad and children, you, yeah, know, they are a bit more solid. Maybe the whole concept was back before when it was single parent families, or I'm going to go back to that Christmas in Nigeria. A lot of Caribbean and African families, maybe the mum came here,
yeah,
and dad stayed home and back in their home country, and whoever was here worked to send money back home.
Yeah.
So maybe that's where that, you know, concept comes, where there's not two parents in the household, because it's not always that, oh, you're just a single parent. No, sometimes it was because someone's here to work. But now we are, we have got that more solid foundation.
Yeah.
It's about building on that foundation. What are we putting in place to then support our upcoming young men and young women?
Yeah.
To, because you, I would not to say stop them from being young parents and whatnot, because some, for some people that works, but when they do have families of their own, how do we support that family staying solid? What are we instilling in them now so that when they get to that stage,
yeah,
they don't need to rely on
government?
But
it's the youngsters seeing it, it's the children, it's the parents setting the example. And back in the day, you know, back in the day, before maybe even Windrush, or that families stay together when you go to Africa, the family unit is quite solid, and families stay together, they don't divorce, they don't break up. But the mindset these days is if it's broken, don't fix it,
yeah,
and just move on.
Yeah.
And then there's a child in the middle, getting pushed from pillar to post, or maybe they don't see the dad's being given a hard time by the mum, and so he doesn't bother, you know, whatever situation they might find themselves in. So, and then that's what causes the discrepancy within the family.
It is, but cycles can always be broken.
Always, yeah.
Because, for example, if we speak of our own experiences, we may come from households where we don't have both of our parents. We didn't grow up with both of our parents, not speaking from personal example, but we may not have grown up with both of our parents, but somehow you've managed to break the cycle.
Yeah.
And it's not because of the example that your parents showed, because they're not together. But that may be an example of, you know what, I was witness to someone else's successful marriage, someone else's successful relationship, and how their family was raised. Their family looked like the family that I want to have. Yes.
So you work towards that.
So it can't always be the example of the parents, because sometimes they don't have that example there.
Yeah.
But then thinking from someone in my position, if I'm someone who's I've got a family unit, and I'm thinking of someone looking onto my situation, how can I support that young person to then see, actually, you may not have seen this growing up, but if this is what you want, this is what it looks like.
Yeah. So what are your thoughts out there, beautiful people? How do you feel? Do you feel that the black family is stronger than ever before? Or is it still quite fragmented and needs some... you know, help, has it been destroyed to the point of not being able to be built up again? All right, so if you just let us know, call us on 07-895-134-713. That's 07-895-134-713. And it's so true, Lily, isn't it, that families are the building blocks of society. So how are we contributing? You made that point, didn't you? You know, how are we contributing to, you know, having stronger family relations? That's with mum, dad, children, grandchildren, you know.
Because it is important, I think, you know, like we have quite a lot of, we get together quite a lot of, as a family, and like my additional family who are friends who have become family, we're always together. So my children are growing up seeing that, you know, they are around that kind of environment quite often. Obviously now lockdown has happened,
but
when we wasn't in lockdown we were always together. Do you know what I mean? So that's the kind of upbringing that they will have, similar to the upbringing that we had. But I do think it goes beyond that. I do think that now we are being put in positions where we can, you know, support the education system, and like you said, do workshops and contribute to certain things. I do think that we need to think more about the bigger picture.
Yeah, and we can't always rely on a system that's been broken for us for a long time. It's about building up new systems, putting in, and I think that that is happening. I think there's a new party, political party, it's a black political party. Maybe we'll talk about that another time, but they're trying to implement certain things that can benefit us as a community. But then going in on what Sonia said about us all being human, and maybe us all working together, because I know a lot of inner city schools, they do have a multicultural you know, base. Well, not all the children are English, Turkish, Somalian, from all walks of life, and they're working really well together, right?
And I think that's one thing that we can take from this. It's not about, I think being with people of different cultures is a beautiful thing. I think being around people of different cultures, it, you learn about different foods, you learn about different music. Like I work with a Somali lady, and I learned things from her of one day of working with her that I did not have a clue about before. And I think that's beautiful. I think you should learn about what other people's cultures are like. Because not only does it open your eyes to something that's different than what you've grown up with, it lessens your ignorance.
Yeah. We've got to learn. Well, don't remain in the ignorance. We just got to learn from each other. And not, you know, like you said, breaking cycles, breaking cycles. So take the time out. You know, and sometimes we got to break down our own barriers because we put those barriers up as well. So instead of us thinking, oh, you know, no, we embrace it. We get to know, and you actually might find that you like it. You know, so not to be stuck in that ignorance, but just learn from these things. Yeah. So what are your thoughts out there? Give us a shout. 07-895-134-713.
The best radio station in the world.
In the world.
Allflavasradio.com
is right here.
Right now.
Hi everyone, this is Shayla Prosper, and I have a new album out, Under My Skin. And with high energy jams like this.
Grab yourself a copy from my website, shaylaprospermusic.com, and enjoy this collection of rich, warm, contemporary soul and R&B cuts that you will enjoy in the playlist years to come. Under My Skin out.
Tune in to All Flavors Radio, Saturdays 8 to 10 with DJ Nige on the Shortiest Show, one of Eve's Lewis' favorite hangouts.
All Flavors Radio is now looking for radio presenters. Email us at info@allflavorsradio.com.
Catch DJ Laro on Sundays with the Caribbean Party, 12 to 2, and The Vibe Show, Tuesdays 8 till 10 on All Flavors Radio.
24/7 playing your favorite artists.
Hi, this is Everton Blender, and it's all about the Old Flavors Radio.
Sit in your man Bushman, and guess what? You got it locked to Old Flavors.
That's scary, yo. I say come take a little winding up. Ayo, it's a girl calling XB, the Booyah Queen, straight out of Dominica. Bigging up All Flavors Radio. Keep it locked.
All Flavors Radio.
My lonely sorrows, shadows of your face up there. I can see all of those happy days, all the times we sail away. Dreams, oh, how can dreams lead me to go away?
Listening to All Flavors.
FLAVASRADIO.com.
When I'm in London, I listen to All Flavors Radio. Shouting out the chat room, Chrissy. DJ Laro, he's on from 8 till 10. Gary Oakley. Joy McCoy. Mark Fujin from Brennan. And Mark will be on from 10 till 12 tonight. Also shouting out Tracy Love. And Sonia Strang-Hendorf. Not forgetting George Flavors, Sarah, and Malaysia, how you guys doing? Charlie Muir, you can catch Charlie Muir tomorrow. I think it's from 7 till 9. And also, we have a new well-being show from our in-house counsellor, Darnell. Also shouting out DJ Nigel, how are you DJ Nigel? You can catch DJ Nigel on a Sunday from 8 till 10. And also Kenny, how are you doing Ken? Not forgetting Guest 600 from London, Guest 727, Guest 931 from Glen Glansbrook, and Guest 956. Shouting out to Carlo and all you silent listeners out there, come on, come and join us in the chat room. Listen to a bit of funk here. Also
also shouting out Kimmy D. How you doing, Kimmy? And all the guys on WhatsApp. How you doing? Olivia. And Doreen. Great to have you all on board. Oh yeah, everybody. Everybody, we're all in this together, right? Would you say, Lily?
Yes,
are we all in this together?
We're all in this together.
Yes, yes. We're shouting out everyone on Facebook as well that's joined us. And it's great to have your company here on All Flavours Radio on the 24th of November. 24th of November, Lily.
I know. It's almost the end of the year.
It's almost the end of the year.
Hmm.
You know, how many weeks till Christmas?
Well, to 24th today, it must be 4 weeks.
Oh, wow. Look at that, guys. Yeah. Look at that. So, you know, this year's almost finished and we will never have another one like it. It just came and it went like, I can't even say, a haze. That's the only way that I can say it was like a haze. Because it was almost like Groundhog Day, you know.
Yeah.
Groundhog Day, but we're not talking about that. See, it's a very good film.
Yeah.
But it was a bad experience. Could you imagine going through that same thing every single day until you got it right?
But that's the thing, he learned something from it in the end.
So yes.
He needed to keep on replaying it till he got it right.
Okay, so have we learned? What have we learned from this whole situation? We're not going to say the C word tonight. Because you know what? It's like we're always talking about it. And there's so much more going on in this world.
Yeah.
Right? I think at the moment they've got crises in Ethiopia.
Mm-hmm.
That's going on. Like, they've loads of refugees fleeing to Sudan.
Wow.
In Ethiopia. That's going on. And also, what's going to be happening in December in this country, again, I know we've highlighted a lot about our race, we've noted a lot about black folk, but this is quite serious, what's going to be happening in December.
Mm-hmm.
And that is that they will be deporting. They don't know the number yet. Jamaicans don't know the number yet. Some of the Windrush nation or Windrush people back to Jamaica in December.
Wow.
Yes. Yes, that's what's going to be happening. And I don't know if anyone's aware of it. I saw a petition going around, was it this week, and thought that I would kind of look into it. And Jamaica have said that in a matter of weeks, migrants from the UK, even as lobbyists attempt to put a halt to the plans, upwards of 20 persons are being readied by the Home Office to be deported. I don't know if you're aware of that. It says a gleaner has learnt of the plans, and you know the plans are already facing backlash, with a number of the UK-based action groups preparing to protest the planned mass deportation. So, mass deportation to Jamaica.
They said that it's the source of, within the Ministry of National Security confirmed on Wednesday that the fight is to take place in the first half of December, but was unable to state how many persons will be deported.
Yeah. Yeah.
But imagine that, being sent back somewhere that you've not been in the last 50 years.
Yeah, I know. It's happened to quite a lot. That happened to a lot of people within the Windrush. There is, however, a new UK policy. We'll look at that in a moment. But there's a website, it's a government website, and it highlights how to go about getting stay in this country.
Mm.
But that might just be a ruse for them to just line people up and send them back.
And that's really another funny thing, isn't it? And it's not funny, but I am in the process of trying to get my Jamaican passport, and, you know,
you're good to say that out loud. They might come for you and deport you back.
I got a British passport. They can't do that.
Begum, let go of Begum, that they took it away. They can do what they want.
Yeah, but she's not British.
She is British, but she ran off to Syria or somewhere, didn't she?
Yeah, because she's a... Never mind.
Yeah, so they can... She is a British citizen, but they revoked her citizenship.
Mm.
And now she's trying to take them to court to get it back.
Yeah, but there was a reason why they revoked her citizenship.
But if they can, that's the message that they're sending out to people, Lily. that's the message that they're sending to people.
I don't know.
That no, even if you were born in this country, we look at the Windrush folk that came here. People, you know, and they're sending them back.
Yeah.
They're sending them back. So, and, you know, people have lost their homes.
It's just such a shame because the whole concept of them being here was because they were invited. Well, I use the word invited very, very loosely. Yeah. But they were told, come work here. You know, we'll give you a house. We'll support you. You come and work with us. We'll make the situation great for you. They come, built up the economy.
Yeah.
And now 50 years later, they're saying, no, we don't want you here no more. Bye.
Well, it's just like using someone, isn't it? They've utilised the purpose. And it's a bit like slavery, isn't it? That's why there's so many displaced black folk in America, because they never wanted them as citizens.
Mm.
They were there to work for free.
Mm.
You know, and likewise here, the same things happened. And it's only because of the crises that happened this year why a lot of the nurses stayed.
Yeah.
A lot of them went, come out of retirement and came to work back in the NHS.
Mm.
So I've put a link in the chat box, guys, in the chat room, that you can access the form. Joe McKay says to sign it. All right. And Joy, if you could give us a little bit more insight into that, because I guess people are running quite scared that if they sign it, they might get sent back. I don't know what the whole situation is. But it says that the new UK immigration policy is from January 2021, free movement will end and the UK will introduce a points-based immigration system. And that's for people, EU and non-EU citizens. Okay, so anyone who wants to, if you want to hire someone to work from outside of the UK, that's excluding Irish citizens. It's quite funny how, why is Ireland not a part of the UK? That's interesting.
Northern Ireland is part of the UK, the rest of Ireland isn't.
Wow.
So the rest of Ireland is part of the European Union.
Well, if you want to come and work in this country, or if you want to hire someone from there, you need to make, or need to apply for permission in advance.
I find this quite interesting because, especially when it talks about how they treat people within the European Union, given that there's a large population of European Union workers that have come to support the NHS.
Yeah.
And, you know, ones that are from this country are not going to university.
Yeah.
There's a large amount that aren't going to university to be nurses, you know, or go into healthcare. And the backbone of healthcare at the moment is basically non-British
nationals,
citizens.
Well, again, this is where we're going to see when everyone does get sent back, or when people are gone, then they're going to see, oh, what have we done? And gonna probably have to put in place other things.
But as this is what I don't understand. If laymen like yourself and myself and many others can look 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years in the future and say, do you know what? You closed your borders to people. You told them to get out, go back to their country, and basically now have nobody left to support the systems that you supposedly put in place for your own people.
Yeah.
We can see that. Why can they not see it?
It's blinded. It's because everyone's doing, but the ones that are making the decisions aren't at grassroots levels.
They're just making the decisions. I'm not talking about the ones that are grassroots. I'm talking about the ones that voted to say, no, no, we don't want to be part of this system anymore.
Mm.
Is it because they just are completely unaware of the fact that, you know, like the ones that sit here and that, oh, they come and take our jobs, but then are you going to be the road sweeper? Are you going to be the housekeeping for the hospitals?
I think a lot of them were whatever wing, because I really don't follow politics in that way, the blue ones, the conservative, right? And so a lot of them had maybe, like I said, moved out from the cities, they bought their homes, they're on their retirement plan or whatever.
Mm.
So they're not directly affected by it. But their offspring, if they have it, or the generations after, are going to be affected by it. But a lot of them want these blue-collar jobs. And who's going to do the rest of the work? The backlash will come from that.
I just don't understand how we can sit here and see that this is just a disaster waiting to happen. Well, but yet those who are making these decisions about immigration and sending Jamaicans back to Jamaica and, you know, things like that, it just doesn't make any sense to me.
Yeah, it's because they're not in it. Sometimes if you're not in a situation, you're never going to see how people are suffering in that situation.
Mm.
And that's what the problem is. It says, there's another point, it says, where do most of the immigrants come from that come to the UK? And it says a majority of these are outside Europe,
mm-hmm.
and often from countries with historical links, so places like Jamaica, or from the Commonwealth. The Commonwealth, does it even exist anymore? Right, but Commonwealth was like India, Jamaica, Australia, mm-hmm. and Nigeria. Well, Nigeria's there again, Lily. You know, so this is where a lot of them come from. So it says if you've overstayed in the UK and left voluntarily at the expense of the Secretary of the State, which means if you've been deported, basically, yeah, and that you'll face a ban for 5 years. And if you were removed, if you left voluntary at the expense of the Secretary of State, then you'll get a ban for 5 years, so you won't be able to come back to the UK for 5 years. But if you were deported, you'll face a ban and not be able to come back for 10 years. So that means you've deported, that they can come back. Right?
But that's what they say. They say you can come back after 5 years, but are they really going to let you back in the country? Given the fact that this is your background, you so-called, you know, supposedly overstayed in the UK, when you get to borders and they say, oh, what are you here for?
Mm.
No, I don't believe that you're going to go back after 14 days. They can put you back on the plane.
I think America will do that, but, you know, the UK is so lax.
Nah, I watch Border Control. They will send you back.
Oh, will they? Mm. Okay. So there's just some information there. And regarding that deportation, and there are lobbyists out there trying to prevent it, because this could be people that have lived here with their whole lives.
Mm.
I don't know the full background information on these individuals, but, you know, this is happening again, December.
Mm.
Right? So much, we're so consumed with this whole corona business. Oh, I said the C word. So consumed with it that there's so much other things that are going on.
Yeah,
that we may be kind of missing.
I do remember that there was one person reading about one gentleman who, I can't remember whether he was born here, and he couldn't find his paperwork, and that's something I just wanted to raise. Is do they, like, for me myself, I know where my passport is, I know where my birth certificate is, I know where certain important pieces of information that relate to my citizenship, where they are.
Yeah.
Is this the time for people to start going and making sure they've got all their papers handy?
Yeah.
You know?
It's quite scary because the Jamaican, let me see where they are, the Home Office,
mm-hmm.
or the Gleaner, they said they tried to get hold of the British High Commission,
mm-hmm.
for comment, but they were unsuccessful. That's quite interesting, isn't it?
No, it's not surprising.
You know, why are they not commenting on this and allowing people to know what is going on?
Because they don't want to make a statement that could be used against them in the future.
Yeah.
That's probably why.
Joyce says, I find this quite disturbing, as this is not a safe time for us Jamaicans, as we have been targeted. I was almost caught in it. Wow. I work with many that was deported. I pray people wake up and realise this need, all hands on deck. Okay, yeah, there is a petition out for this, actually. I'm going to try and find the link for the petition. And if we can, remember we spoke before about signing petitions.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that, you know, sometimes you think, oh, is this real, is it not? Mm-hmm. But if they get 100,000 signatures, you know, on a petition, then Parliament will look at it. Or they'll at least look at it,
mm-hmm.
and see if something can be done about it, right? So, but it is urgent action that's needed, because, guys, it's the 24th of November. Next week, Tuesday, is it the 2nd? 29th?
Yeah, Tuesday's right? The 2nd.
Right, or is it the 1st?
The 3rd is on Thursday.
Right? Mm. So, this needs some urgent, urgent assistance. I will put everything, a link into the, again, the chat. So come into the chat room, join us, and you can get hold of all this information, because you might know somebody, you know, that could benefit from this, or just sign the petition so that we can get those numbers down, can get all those numbers back down, and hopefully get 100,000 signatures on that, so the government will actually have a look at it.
Yeah, and I think now is the time to kind of learn what your rights are and things like that, because there's a lot of things that are being put in front of us, being put in place, that you may, or we may feel that, oh, I'm being forced to do this, I haven't got a choice, when actually you do have a choice, you do have a voice. But making sure that you are legislation, law literate.
Yeah, we have to start reading, guys. This is another thing. They say if you want to hide something from a black person, just put it in a book.
That's terrible.
Right, let's change that. Let's change that whole thought. Like, no, let's be readers. Readers are leaders.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let's change this thinking, because they're always like negative on these kind of things. So go in and even read, if it's a snippet of legislation, share it amongst 10 people and come together and discuss it.
Mm-hmm.
Because then, you know, there's support in numbers.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so even just going along and signing that petition and going along and signing that form that we've put into, did we put that into the chat, Lily? The one for the ethnic disparities?
No.
All right, I'll put that one into the chat as well. Okay, so there's a lot going on, beautiful people. There's a lot going on.
Mm.
So sometimes things are smoke screens in order to cover our eyes, so we're not open to the real things that are going on right underneath our nose, because we're so consumed with what they're trying to tell us.
Mm.
And law and legislation and all policy is being passed, and it's passing us by, and it is actually affecting us on a really big scale. All right, so just think about that, and we'll see you in 5.
The People's Station.
Shouting out everyone in the chat room. There's a bit of a Desmond Dekker there, and Dennis Brown, I think, sang the first one. So we're just shouting out Chrissy and DJ Laro, who's on from 8 to 10 tonight. Gary Oakley, Joy McKay, Mark Philogene, who's on from 10 till 12, Mr. Fix It, and Kimmy B. Thank you for joining us all, and everyone around the world, everyone on WhatsApp, and everyone on Facebook and other platforms, tune in and so forth. So, Lily, we've been quite heavy tonight, don't you think?
Yeah, we have.
Heavy on the conversation.
Full on.
But sometimes things just have to be spoken about,
mm-hmm.
you know, otherwise it passes us by, and, you know, just alerting others to the fact of, I guess, what's going on outside as well.
Yeah.
But there's something really nice that I thought would finish up the show with, and that is that British Vogue X BMX UK,
mm-hmm.
or BMW, should I say, UK, that they have a scholarship program.
Lovely.
That's on. So I'm going to put that link as well in the chat box. And again, you can share this stuff with youngsters who you feel maybe are looking for something, because obviously coming out of this whole situation that we're in at the minute, a lot of us are going to be looking for work, a lot of us are going to be looking for various other things.
Mm-hmm.
So this British Vogue and BMW, they've partnered up to launch their first Vogue /BMW UK scholarship programme, and it's a 4-month paid placement beginning in 2021.
That's amazing.
Yeah. So it's British Vogue and BMW's central office in London and Farnborough. That's where the placements will take place. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So your thoughts, Lily?
I think that's amazing. I think we spoke about this before with one of the other
internships that was paid.
Mm.
And I hope they spread the word. It was November the 13th. That was the cutoff date for that, wasn't it? But I think these things are so important to share because we was talking about the family earlier and how we invest in our younger ones to secure their future.
Yeah.
And these are the things that can help put them on the right path. I mean, getting paid for this kind of experience is, yeah, it's really, really good. It's really, really good.
And the nice thing is that it's paid for 4 months
mm.
and it's in London and Farnborough. Working with brands such as BMW, Mini, Rolls-Royce, BMW, but I'm not too sure if it's like an engineering because it wasn't quite straight. But I guess if you go on and find out a bit more, the application closes on the 11th of December. So I have posted it into the chat room. So if you're not in listening, everyone that is in the chat room, please just grab the link and share that with other people. If you might know youngsters that might be interested in this scholarship.
So there's quite a lot of placements. It says there will be 3 placements each 4 months in the duration across 2021. So 4 months,
so three, 12.
Yeah, it's 12 quite placements. A few placements that they're offering. And that's 3 placements each 4 months. So
yeah, and that's for residents that are aged 18 plus. Their start date is to be confirmed, but it is across, it is in 2021.
Mm.
So just be prepared for that. Once you've applied, I'm sure they'll give you more details on it. All right, so it says you've got to have an entry-level prorated salary, 8.5 days holiday plus UK bank holidays, which is nice. So it's that's quite nice, you know, and you'll be working with some of the top automobile companies. Motorcycles as well, so premium financial and mobility services, BMW Group.
And even if it's just for the experience, you know, like I've come across quite a few youngsters recently that say they don't really know what they want to do when they finish school. And at 18 you're kind of in that interim, should I go to uni, or you're applying for uni or looking for a job. So this would be something that maybe someone who's a bit on the fence about what they should do next. This would be good to support them.
It's a great opportunity. Lots of nice little opportunities, I think, out there. It's just a matter, again, of doing our research and looking to find what's out there for people.
Yeah.
And our young people at that, because they are the future.
Yes.
Right? And I do know that in this time, a lot of people have possibly lost out on work and various other things, but things will get better.
Yeah.
Things will get right, you know, and it's just a matter of having that faith that they will, having that forethought and having that strong, strong conviction that things will get better. Lily, you have something to say?
Yes, and it's funny that you speak about faith. So we've said that we're going to come away from the 48 laws of power, and we were going to look into Napoleon Hill's Think and Grow Rich. Now, obviously, the book is Think and Grow Rich in the terms of monetary kind of wealth, but you can apply this in any kind of rich. Be rich spiritually, be rich mentally, be rich within yourself, you know, just your whole being. And the portion that I chose was the second step, which is actually faith.
Awesome.
And it says here, faith is the head chemist of the mind. When faith is blended with the vibration of thought, the subconscious mind instantly picks up the vibration, translates it into its spiritual equivalent, and transmits it to infinite intelligence, as in the case of prayer.
Yeah,
and I just wanted to read this little passage because I thought this poem was quite good, and it kind of brings together everything that we were saying when we were talking about change, and that we as a human race should see each other as humans, but just how we think can impact a situation. So it says, if you think you are beaten, you are. If you think you dare not, you don't. If you like to win, but you think you can't, it is almost certain you won't. If you think you'll lose, you're lost. For out of the world, we find success begins with a fellow's will. it's all in the state of mind. If you think you are outclassed, you are. You've got to think high to rise. You've got to be sure of yourself before you can ever win a prize. Life's battles don't always go to the stronger or faster man, but soon or late, the man who wins is the man who thinks he can.
Yes. So there was just one word that kept coming through there for me. Think.
It's, and that's the word that's in italics.
Right. It's thought. It's our thoughts. Our thoughts govern our outcomes. So what we think is what we feel.
Yeah.
All right. What we think is what we bring forth.
Yeah.
All right. So, yeah. Faith that things are going to change for the better. We spoke earlier regarding that Sainsbury's advert and the covert racism and things that we see. Think that these things will change. Joy McKay earlier said that, didn't she? That let's work for change. All right, let's work for change.
Yeah.
But we've seen that. Joy says Tyler Perry is a great example, not just of family, but role models are missing. That was obviously to the section about families.
Yeah.
And is the black family being destroyed, basically? And we know that we can work towards building, think on building greater families, and we will have that. Yeah, Lily?
Manifestation is key. Yes. Whatever you feed into your mind, whatever you're thinking in your mind, if you are going to manifest it, if you're going to say it out loud, then make it something positive.
Yes.
If we think it's going to change, it will.
Absolutely, and write it down. Write everything down. I was going for my journal because I do journaling. So I've started December, almost near the end of the year. And some of the things I've written down, I'm like, oh my goodness, it's happened, it's done.
Yeah.
You know, so journaling is an amazing thing, guys. Just write down your thoughts, write down your gratitudes, write down what you appreciate and what we're thankful for. Because when we are writing down what we're thankful for, we're not worrying about what we're not thankful for.
Exactly.
All right, so think on those things. So we do have a little section here of live and not necessarily unsigned artists, and it's like 7:40. The time is just always going so fast in here, you know, and it's amazing and great to have you got your company and wonderful. And I'm just going to shout out all of the DJs that have done an amazing job on the station. Thank you so much, George Flavas, for giving us this opportunity, giving us this platform in order to encourage, upbuild, and really just speak to our community about these things. So just shouting out George Flavors, Love to Sal in Malaysia, and also DJ Laro and Maureen. DJ Laro's on tonight from 8 till 10. He's on after me, along with DJ Nige. I'm fumbling. Sorry, Mark Philogene, who's on from 10 till 12. Also shouting out DJ Slim, great show last night. DJ Slim's on a Monday and a Friday night. And DJ Nige, who is on a Sunday and a Saturday night. Shout out to Charlie Muir, who will be on tomorrow. And along with Darnell. Darnell is on Wednesday this week from 9 to 11. He's a new therapist that will be coming in and talking about well-being. Highlighting also the original Mr. Fix It, great show last night, and you can catch Mr. Fix It on a Monday, a Friday, and also a Sunday, along with Ninja Man Lloyd, who's on a Thursday and Sunday, and John J.E. plays on a Sunday, but you can catch him throughout the week playing some amazing, amazing music. So guys, big up to you all. And thank you, George, again. Once again, we are looking for DJs. So if you feel that you can come on board, present and DJ, come on. Go to the allflavors.com website and sign up. Okay, guys. So this track here is from DiCarlo and it's called My Mama Don't Play.
DiCarlo says thank you. Mama say thank you. This is specially dedicated to my mama on Mama's Day.
I love you in every way.
Where were you been? Did I tell you? You must come in straight from school. And don't play around with the people out there. Because there's mad people out there. And you'll get yourself hurt. What do I tell you all the time? Must listen, boy. Must you ask, damn it. Go find yourself up in your room. And go do some studying. Right now. You hear me? Join me in the tonight. To be rude in any way, that would be disrespectful and give her the okay for me to get my ass bust. My mama was too dangerous. Oh, my mama don't play. No, yeah. My mama don't play. Oh, oh. Four children made life really hard. So much pressure made mama pray to the Lord. Clothes on her backs, food on the table. All by herself, mama was able. Now some of you moms struggle with one. Don't know how to cook, take away for some. You teach them how to swear, we'll teach them not to care. They won't have no respect, what do you expect?
Couldn't backchat her in any way. No, no. Boy, you're two-faced. My mama don't play. No. Now my mama didn't play the kind of games that people play. When she tell me to do something, I would do it right away. Because I know what I will get, I must ask you to get it. So tell me that I know.
You might leave my side. You may, cause change is bound to come and bring what no man wants. No one wants hurt. No one wants pain. To laugh in the sun and live through the shame. And lose all your thoughts tonight. You wanna gallivant and lose all your thoughts tonight. When your smoke is out, who's gonna light your fire? The cold sometimes is lessons learned inside. I wanna dance like fire. 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 Leave it to me, leave it to me. Let me open my eyes and see. Let that sea comes when we meet. Cause faith is stronger than disbelief. Nothing but change is upon you. Nothing but change. Nothing but change is upon you. Tonight, you wanna gallivant and lose all your. tonight. When your smoke is out, who's gonna light your fire? The cold sometimes is lessons learned in time. I wanna dance like fire. 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 I wanna dance like fire.
Track here done by Elay Weeks, produced by Black Lotus.
I wanna dance like fire. I wanna dance like fire. I wanna dance like fire.
And that first track was done by DiCarlo. All available on iTunes. Shouting out Chrissy, DJ Laro, DJ Nige, Gary Oakley, Joy McKay, thank you so much for your interactions and company tonight. Mark Philogene, the original Mr. Fix It, Pele, nice to have you on board, and Kimmy B, and everyone around the world on TuneIn, on WhatsApp, Doreen, and Cal. And yes, thank you so much for your company tonight. So that's for our live and unsigned section. I think I'm going to do one day where I will just play lots of live and unsigned. There's some really great artists coming into the studio, and we'll be having a lot more interactions with these guys on the cusp of the new year. So 2021, lots of good things to look forward to. So overall for tonight, I think when it comes to that Sainsbury's advert, Lily, I think that Sonia summed it up really well, mm-hmm. about us being human. Yeah. And obviously some people are going to just remain in their ignorance. You mm-hmm. have to leave them there. But we got to move on and know that we're more than just a colour, yes, as it were, right?
Definitely.
And there's always going to be someone out there who doesn't like something about us. If it wasn't our colour, it might be something else. You know, no, seriously.
It's true. There's always going to be something that someone doesn't like about us. Yeah. There's always going to be something that they envy about us. That's why they make a statement as to why they may treat us a certain way, is because they're actually envious of what they see.
Yes. Yeah. So
sometimes we have to think of it that way. Maybe, yeah, it's just that they're a bit upset that they don't
just
have all the glory.
Have the fabulousness. Yes, so remember, we are just all human, and that is it in a nutshell. But also, how there are some great opportunities out there for our youngsters. So guys, if you can, please share those links in the chat room, in the chat boxes in the chat room, as well as signing that petition as regards to the deportees, okay, that are going to be deported back to Jamaica. And that is on the early side of December. So we've got another small window, the same as the window of that careers opportunity, mm-hmm. is the same window that we have for that deportation. So there's lots of forms and lots of information in the chat room. So come on, join us in the chat room, even if it's just to come and get that information. And yeah, we can all play our part. As Joy, as you rightfully said, we can all bring about change. But it's one foot in front of the other,
mm-hmm.
and we've all have to, yeah, it's a sign that Joy says, please sign the petitions, people, that will bring change. Yes. Remember, 100,000 signatures will get it in front of the MPs. What they do with it next, I'm not sure, but we can always have a voice in these situations. All right, so we do hope that you've enjoyed what we played for you tonight. And yes, shout out to all the amazing DJs on allflavasradio.com. Here, bringing you a variety of music and chat and just a sheer variety for everyone that is out there listening. So thank you. And we will see you next week, right? Next Tuesday.
Yeah.
On every Tuesday, 6 to 8. Follow me as DJ Laro, followed by Mark Philogene. So I guess all we have left to say tonight is, Lily,
we'll see y'all on the other side.
Now take care.